Hey guys, this is David Kwan, and today is Sunday, so it is Philosophical Sunday for me, where I talk about religion, atheism, and even science. I guess because fine-tuning argument could be considered a scientific argument, kind of. The premises are actually at least scientific. The conclusion is not scientific. The premise being that there are constants in the universe, constants such as speed of gravity, speed of light, and the universal constant. And if you change any one of them to a tiny amount, like 0.0001 to the millionth power percent, if you change it to that, even to that little degree, you change the universe enough that life on Earth would not be possible, right? So, fine-tuning argument, thus creationists thus from this point argue that thus, the universe seems so finely tuned that there must be a God or an intelligent designer behind this whole universe. And I made two videos on this so far, responding to this argument. The first video, you know, I talked about how, why involve God at all? There are so many other explanations in which God is not involved that explains how this universe could be finely tuned. In the second video, I said, all right, fine. Let's assume there is an intelligent designer. How can you conclude that the intelligent designer is the God of the Bible or the God of the Quran or any other such one God? In fact, in the previous video, my second video on this topic, I talked about how it makes much more sense for there to be multiple gods in a universe like this. Because this universe is not perfect. If there is one God who had one purpose and one agenda, and this is how he created the universe to be, then he is an asshole. Seriously, why would you create a universe like this? At least asshole to us. Maybe he's not an asshole to some other being, or some other whatever. But to us, it is totally, totally not fair. Because the universe is so huge. Remember, if we're talking about like percentage, and this is a grossly over-exaggerated estimation. But inside, in this universe, I'm living in New York City. And New York City is part of New York State. New York State is part of United States of America. United States of America is part of North America continent. And North America continent is part of planet Earth. Planet Earth, in which the landmass, like North America, is 30%, and 70% of planet Earth is actually water. Human beings cannot live in water. We haven't developed technology for that. So we can't. Our biology is not designed for that. I would say we are not evolved to do that. We're able to swim in it, but we can't live in it. Right? So there's this planet Earth. And we can only inhabit 30% of planet Earth, which is already like, kind of not fair. If you made planet Earth, why not allow human beings to be able to live on most of it? But that's not even the problem. The problem is, planet Earth is one planet out of 8 planets inside this solar system. And if you compare the size of planet Earth to the other planets, it's not that big. Mars is bigger than us. Saturn, Jupiter. Jupiter is about 20 times bigger than the size of planet Earth. And then there's the Sun, which is the center of the solar system. The Sun, I don't know, is about 100 times as big as the planet Earth. I might be wrong on that. I definitely don't have any source with me, so that's just an overly exaggerated estimate or underestimate. I don't know. But it's certainly bigger than planet Earth, is what I'm getting at. But that's just one solar system. There's thousands of other solar systems in one galaxy, the Milky Way galaxy. But that's just one galaxy. There's billions of galaxies in the universe, and that's just one universe. Remember in the first video I talked about the possibility of multiple universes? Yeah, that's just one universe. So, out of all that, and the universe is finite, as science is telling us, so what we're seeing right now is what we're able to see, but the universe might actually be bigger than what we're able to see currently. Might not be. But the point is, the universe that we have observed so far, which does involve billions of galaxies, so out of all the billions of galaxies, There doesn't seem to be any life in it, or we just haven't detected any forms of life that are similar to us, because when we are looking for life, when scientists are searching for life on other planets, they're searching for water, because water is a key component of life on Earth. But that again is lack of imagination. Life may not be require water in other parts of the universe. But in any case, there's no water except in planet Earth. And planet Earth is like 0.00000000001% of the entire universe. Why does a God, if a God loves the human race and designed the universe for the human race, why did God make the universe so inhospitable for you, for humans, for 99.99999% of the universe? That doesn't make any sense. Really. If there was an intelligent designer who finely tuned the universe, it certainly could have been designed better. It could have been more finely tuned so that the universe supports life better. So that, like, this doesn't make any sense. To logically conclude that this universe is the result of an intelligent God who is perfect in every way is weird. Also, the universe is not perfect. Christopher Hitchens made this point a lot. But Andromeda Galaxy is expanding. You know, see, the universe is expanding, but the crazy thing is, each galaxy is also expanding. That's crazy, because Milky Way galaxy is expanding in a way, and alongside us, Andromeda galaxy is expanding. It's expanding toward us. Andromeda galaxy is expanding toward us. What happens when the two galaxies meet? They start just crumbling apart. So, in some future, when an Andromeda galaxy actually touches Milky Way galaxy and starts encroaching on us, and Milky Way galaxy starts encroaching on Andromeda galaxy, that expansion could possibly reach planet Earth, and that expansion might completely destroy all life on planet Earth. Yeah, talk about perfect design for humans, right? What kind of a God designs the universe this way? Maybe that's what Revelation is talking about, that the ultimate ending. Maybe that's when rapture happens, when Andromeda Galaxy comes to us. Sarcasm aside, this is a universe in which human beings have, I have nipples, and as a guy, I have no use for nipples. I have appendix, which I don't have a need for. I have wisdom teeth that I had to pull out, and it was painful. That I had no need for, and was pulled out by dental surgery. I'm not perfect. The universe is not perfect. If there's a perfect God out there, he certainly didn't create this universe. That's where fine-tuning falls apart. And also, whether it's finely tuned or not is extremely debatable, because that conclusion is totally based on the premise that these constants can't be changed. Speed of gravity can't be changed in order to have life. Why not? Is it really true that speed of gravity has to be 9.8 whatever decimals meters per second per second? Maybe it's true for this universe. Maybe it's true for planet Earth. But couldn't there be some other planet with different speed of gravity, with different speed of light? If the properties were changed if these properties were changed, we would have a universe without life, is, again, overreaching. It's actually really controversial at this point. The fact about the immutability of the constants. It's actually super constant. Scientists still haven't figured out how many constants that we can actually define as constants. Is it 23 constants, 21 constants, 17 constants? We haven't ironed that out yet. So even though we haven't ironed that out yet, you're going to argue that these constants are what makes the universe finely tuned? Yeah. Okay. Sure. Let's just jump to the conclusion, because that's what a religious book has us doing. Science is not about jumping to conclusion. When we make hypotheses, yeah, we jump to conclusion. We say, okay, I hypothesize that the universe is eternal, And then we kind of observe the universe, you know, that the universe has always existed. And it turns out, through studies on radioactive decay and studying of time and distance and measuring that, well, actually, it actually seems like the universe had a beginning. Oh my gosh, my hypothesis was wrong. Let's change my hypothesis. I hypothesized that the universe has a beginning, and it seems to be true now. But I also hypothesized there are multiple universes. That's jumping to conclusion, yes. But science is not about believing that, jumping that conclusion as an absolute truth. It's about testing the observations around the universe to see how true that hypothesis is. Whereas this book, the Bible, for example, automatically just states with absolute certainty that God created the sky and the ground, or the heaven and the earth. And automatically we're to assume that God created the world in 6 days. That's what it says, 6 days. You can interpret that 6 days however you want it to, but the actual text says 6 days. And you had to do a mental gymnastics to make that make sense to you. Science doesn't have to make that kind of mental gymnastics. We just change our hypotheses. We say, okay, we were wrong on that, but this seems to be the truth about the universe. And that's why I like the fine-tuning theory, because it does seem to have pretty good premises in the beginning. The premises aren't 100% certain. It's not even 60% certain, because there's a lot of controversy on how immutable those constants are. But it does seem like there is a good amount of constants. You know, the speed of gravity, for depending on different planets, for example. The speed of light is definitely a constant. But how dependent all these other constants are to each other is still scientifically debatable. It hasn't been established yet. So from that on, the premises could be wrong, in which case the fine-tuning argument could be completely wrong. It could be completely wrong, in which case to conclude from the fine-tuning argument that God is the one behind the fine-tuning, again, not right, not correct. So, but even if it was correct, like, even if there's an intelligent designer behind this fine-tuning, because of the universe is the way it is, it's really hard to conclude that the being behind this universe is a perfect God. I mean, maybe his definition of perfect is different than mine, but this universe certainly isn't perfect. It's beautiful. There's a lot of beauty in the universe. There's a lot of wondrous things about the universe. But the universe as a whole, there are certain parts of it that's incredibly fucked up. That's just really, really crazy, batshit, insane. What kind of God would design the universe this way and call it perfect and call it good? So those are my points on this fine-tuning argument. Hope you guys enjoyed it. Next video, I will be talking about something different. I haven't really quite decided what that would be yet, but stay tuned for next Sunday. Cheers.